In partnership with Blades Belong on Your Feet and the Hockey Art Co, welcome Chelmsford Chieftains Canadian import Damon Porter. How you doing, fella?
Doing good. Thanks for having me.
Now, you're very, very welcome, mate. Not looking as pretty as you did the other day. You got a little mark between the eyes there. How's that held up?
Yeah, it's a new battle wound. I'm kind of used to it. I've had a few scars across my face in previous years, but yeah, it's unfortunate there's no penalty called. That was kind of the frustrating point, part of the whole thing, but it's all right.
Yeah, I think we'll probably get onto that a little bit later. I mean, what I wanted to start with was obviously the tone of the evening with what happened recently in ice hockey. There was a notable sort of pause where everyone kind of took a breath in when you went down on Sunday night. And then when you come up with blood visibly coming from your face, there was a very noticeable sort of gasp. Was it a stick blade, was it, that caught you?
Yeah, I was in the middle of a shot and just saw black tape right in between my eyes. And yeah, just high stick right in the face. But thankfully, nothing too serious. I know it's the first thing I actually thought about as well when it all happened. I saw the blood. So yeah, I mean, it's definitely in the back of everyone's mind still. And it's obviously very fresh. So happily, nothing too serious. But yeah, it's definitely in the back of everyone's minds.
Yeah, I think it's always a stark reminder, isn't it? That, you know, regardless of whatever safety protocols you put in place, you are big, strong, fast guys with extremely sharp blades on your feet and, you know, weapons in your hands.
Definitely. Yeah. No, it's when you think about hockey in general terms, it is kind of a barbaric sport. And I mean, you don't even think about it when you play. Obviously, something like what happened to Adam. I mean, I think I was a pretty uneasy the first practice back after everything. I think the whole team was, in all honesty. You could just kind of feel it in the air with everyone, and even talking to a lot of people back home, like, it's definitely traveled the world, the news about him and the precautions everyone's taking.
So back home is Calgary, is it?
Yeah, Calgary, Alberta.
Yeah, so it was no choice but winter sport, really, I suppose, growing up.
Yeah, no, you get about 10 months of snow on the ground, so there's not much else you can do besides freeze it and skate on it. And then you get 2 months of summer, so we try and golf as much as we can for those 2 months. But yeah, hockey is basically my life. It's in my blood. It's in every Canadian's blood. It's our sport, I guess, like football is over here. It's what every kid grows up playing. So it's hard not to love it. Sorry.
Yeah, and there's an incredible picture on your social media that of you skating on a lake, sort of in a mountain range. Whereabouts is that exactly?
That's about 30 minutes from my house. So yeah, I'm pretty lucky where I live back home. It's a beautiful area to call home. And I mean, me and my buddies, since I was a little kid, my family and I, we go out there and just enjoy the scenery. And yeah, you fall in love with the sport, just being able to go play on any frozen pond in the mountain areas, and anywhere you can find water, snow, there's usually a rink within a kilometer or two. So
have you found anywhere in Essex that's equally as beautiful as that?
You know what? It's a different kind of beauty. I've really enjoyed it here. The boys have made it really easy for me as an adjustment moving from Canada. Obviously, I mean, we have a great locker room, and I couldn't name one guy in the room that I'm not a fan of. I mean, I've absolutely loved every guy on this team so far, and they've gone out of their way to make sure I'm comfortable and happy. I mean, you only get to skate so much in a week, and you spend so many hours away from the rink, and you know, they've gone above and beyond making sure I'm comfortable, happy, and enjoying the social life as well still. So yeah, it's been good.
That's excellent. Are you nice and close to the rink?
Yeah, I'm just in the Great Battle area, so I'm about 10 minutes from the rink. So I usually put on my running shoes in the morning, go for a jog or something to the rink, go to the gym or something like that, just to stay, keep my mind sane. Some days are long when we're not skating and stuff like that. But yeah, no, I'm right in Chelmsford, which is nice. So
are you working here as well?
Not yet. I'm probably going to be getting something going here in the next week or two. That's kind of why I've been a gymaholic lately and just kind of keep my mind sane. But yeah, work will definitely help speed up some of the days where we're not playing and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. So the start of your career, obviously it would have been incredibly young. I'd imagine skates on your feet before you could properly walk.
Yeah, I think the first photo of me with skates on, I was like two or three years old. My dad was dragging me around on the outdoor rink. I had an outdoor rink in my backyard from the age of like 5 till about 12, I think, when we moved. We lived out on an acreage, so we had a lot of land. My dad went out of his way to build a full-on ice hockey rink. He had my favorite team's logo at center ice, so I was pretty lucky in that sense. And yeah, that's like my fondest memories of hockey growing up, having the whole neighborhood over and just play hockey until you're getting called in to go to bed for school in the morning.
Are you Flames? Are you Calgary Flames? Are you?
Yeah, Calgary Flames fan.
Yeah, isn't it about time a Canadian won that Stanley Cup?
It's been way too long. I know the Flames were close in 2004. We're pretty salty talking about that still back home, but yeah, it'd be nice to see a Canadian team hoist the cup.
Well, I'm a Leafs fan, so I know plenty about being salty about not winning anything.
Yeah, they've got a tough history.
So then you joined the Chieftains from the Arizona State University setup. So how did that come about? You sort of playing as a junior and then getting into Arizona State.
Yeah, I was honestly, I think I was 19 or 20 years old playing juniors back in Canada, and just kind of getting to that point where school was obviously the next thing on my mind. And I was going to actually just hang the skates up and go to school locally. And then I got contacted by Arizona State, I think in the middle of the summer, and it's kind of a no brainer. I mean, being able to show up to the rink in shorts and your flip flops every day, it's hard to pass up on. I mean, the weather there it's like paradise. So I do miss that kind of weather, but yeah, it was a fun 4 years. Obviously we had COVID, so we had to miss a full season, which kind of sucked, but I definitely improved my golf game being down there for 4 years. So that was a bonus.
Have you ever got out at Scottsdale?
Yeah, I lived about 10 minutes from Scottsdale, so we had to get dragged out of there a few weekends. But no, we had a pretty responsible team. Obviously, we have fun when there's no weekend. We have some weekends, with no games. But Scottsdale, yeah, it's a tough spot to beat for sure.
Yeah, how's that par 3 16th?
Sorry?
How's that par 3 16th?
The 3 16th, what do you mean, sorry?
On Scottsdale course, the par 3.
Oh yeah, you know, believe it or not, I was at the Waste Management Open 2 years ago. I got to witness one of the hole in ones, and I remember is beer cans literally being thrown in every which direction. That was probably the coolest golf memory I have, is being able to go to that. I got to go to it 3 times while I was down there, so I was spoiled in that sense. But yeah, that tournament is one of a kind. It's pretty loud, and you can have some fun walking around that course.
Yeah, Arizona, I suppose, as a state, is quite similar to England in the fact that hockey's not really a main theme down there,
and but
it's growing really fast.
It's growing rapidly. Yeah, I mean, my family has a property down there, so I've been going down there since I was a little kid. And I mean, I remember going there when I was like 7 or 8 years old, and people didn't even know what hockey was. And then obviously, Austin Matthews kind of put Arizona on the map for hockey. And I think in the last 8 or 9 years, it's just growing rapidly every year. And so many ex-NHL players, they buy property down there and retire. And so their kids get in and they try and coach and grow the game. So yeah, I've seen a massive, massive growth in hockey in the Southern States, which is good to see. It's good for the game.
Let's put ourselves in a little fantasy moment then. You get two calls, Flames and the Coyotes. What are you doing?
I'd probably have to stick with the Flames, battle out the winters. Yeah, I'm a diehard Flames fan, so it'd be tough to pass up on that.
It's somewhere, even as a Leafs fan, I think we've fully accepted that we've probably got Matthews until he wants to go home.
Yeah, I know. It'll be tough to keep him the next contract. I don't know. I could see him staying, but I could also see him trying to go home. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
It will, yeah. I think he'll definitely end up back there. With the room at the Chieftains, I think the golf day must be incredibly interesting, because I can think of at least 3 scratch golfers in that room.
There's some incredible golfers on our team. Yeah, I've gotten out with the Bartlett twins. They're both pretty phenomenal. I've played probably the most with Ollie. He takes me. We get out probably once a week at least, or something like that. And the impressive one though is Jordan Laude. He's told me he just got into it a few months ago. We had a pretty close match. So I don't know. I don't know about that.
I think he's technically a pro.
Yeah, I was in Beeves hitting some shots where I definitely wasn't hitting 4 months into golf. But no, it's nice to have a bunch of guys that like to golf. I mean, it definitely helps on the off days, and you get out on the course with all them, and it just builds that camaraderie and friendship. So yeah, I've been privileged in that sense to have a bunch of golfers on the team.
Yeah, it's very noticeable amongst Chieftains fans that there is a camaraderie amongst the lads. There's a very, very united front from everybody, which is not something that we had last year. It was a bit disjointed. Coming in this year, obviously Lewis Clifford is new, as you are. How have you found it under Cliff, and has the level been what you were expecting?
You know, for the second part of your question, the level has actually been above and I didn't really know what to expect. It's been above and beyond what I thought. I mean, you know, there's some players on our team who I think would fit right in back home and a lot of teams I've played with. And Cliff has been above and beyond. He's helped me in every way possible getting over here and making sure I'm okay. And what I like the most about him, I think, is just how straightforward he is. There's no like hidden messages in what he's trying to give out. I mean, it's pretty clear what he expects of us, and it makes it a lot easier, I think, for us. And he's very approachable, and I can go talk to him about anything. And I mean, I've been here for, I think, 2 months now. And yeah, it feels like I've known most of these guys for years, which has been really nice. We have a very close-knit locker room. Guys go to the rink. Everyone looks forward, I think, going to the rink whenever we have practice or games. And I think it shows, it reflects on the ice. I mean, I feel like our team can beat anyone on any given night. We beat ourselves some nights, which is frustrating, but it's a work in progress, obviously. I think we have some new faces on the team and guys are learning how other guys play. But for the most part, I think we've done an exceptional job so far, especially from what I've heard from last year. So yeah, it's been a really positive environment, which is really all you can ask for coming from across the pond, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a bit of a frustrating result Sunday night, just gone. That's the start, the first 30 minutes, certainly at least, was incredible from everybody. Every time you got the puck, they just did not know which way you were going to go.
Yeah, no, I was excited. I mean, obviously, the stick in the face kind of halted that night pretty quickly for me. But I felt good. I thought the boys looked really good. We just got to get over these little lapses I think we have in certain times of games. And it's only going to get better, I think, with our team, really. I think it's just only going to keep improving. And I'm hoping by the end of the year, we can put together just full 60s every night and be a hard team to beat on any given night. Sorry.
Yeah. How did it come around then? How did Cliff sort of find you and contact you over in the States?
You know, I had, in all honesty, after ASU, I was basically retired. I was golfing like all summer with my parents and my buddies. And then I got contacted about the Chieftains, and it was kind of in the back of my mind. Took a couple weeks just to think if I should, you know, pursue like a big boy job and get into the workforce and all that. Or I don't know. I just had it was itching me all summer. I wanted to keep playing. And yeah, Cliff, we kept in touch, texting all summer long. And yeah, just pulled the trigger on it, I think, a month before I ended up coming over here. And yeah, it was kind of quick turnaround. But yeah, no, I have a British citizenship. Actually, my father was born in Glasgow,
right,
in the 70s. So with the citizenship, I think that helped a bit with getting over here. And I wanted to study law. And there's a program here in England where I can get a law degree in like 2 years. So it kind of made sense to come over here, play hockey, and then try and get a law degree as well while I'm at it.
Brilliant. I did hear on the grapevine, because I've found since doing this that I tend to find a lot of grapevines,
yeah,
that are hanging about, that there might be another Canadian player that or an American player that you were looking at getting over here.
Yeah, we've kind of been texting back and forth. He's a hell of a player as well. He's just kind of dealing with some stuff back home and trying to get all that all figured out. So, I mean, if he's willing to play, it'll definitely be over here. So yeah, we're slowly picking away at that. We'll see what, yeah, see,
because there's still an import slot on the Chieftains roster, as far as
I know. Yeah, I've been texting him a lot, actually. We've been going back and forth. I mean, if he's going to go anywhere, it's going to be here. We're just trying to figure all that out and see what works best for him in life right now.
Yeah, excellent. And you said law is your sort of, was that your major in university?
I studied business, and then I studied psychology. So I got 2 degrees in Arizona. And then, I mean, I'd love to be like a player agent or a sports psychologist. So that's why I took the psychology, and then wanted to get a law degree just to kind of amplify all that. I know it's funny. I actually I did not like school at all growing up. I just wanted to live on the ice. But I think once I went to college, I kind of realized I'm all right at it. And yeah, no, the law part's kind of new in the last like year, kind of turned my attention towards that. So trying to get all that figured out. And try and pursue something with player development or an agency after I'm done playing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's I mean, you see a lot of people as well would like, I mean, with obviously the injury you've had there, injuries that you might have had, you said, you know, a few scars on your face. Have you still got all your teeth, or are you going to sort of wait till you're done playing and then get everything sorted?
Yeah, I've been knock on wood here.
I'll knock on mine as well.
I've got all my teeth still. I took a slap shot right here when I was like 16, directly in the face, and I split my lip completely open right here. I could put my tongue through it and somehow didn't lose a single tooth in that. So I was lucky there. But yeah, I've still got them all, thankfully.
Definitely strong there. So I've had a couple of questions that have come in from some Chieftains fans.
Okay.
And you've got away with it. Normally I get some quite unbroadcastable stuff from the room.
Yeah.
Although Dan Hitchens has asked, have you seen a fox?
That's a funny question. So yeah, in Canada, like, it's like nothing out of the ordinary to drive to school and see like a moose or a bear or a cougar or anything, or like a wolf. And a fox is something I've like never seen. So our first road trip, we were, I think we were playing against Slough in Slough, and we were all walking to the car after the game, and a fox ran like directly in front of us, and I like freaked out, and they thought that was like the funniest thing. So yes, I have seen a fox here.
Yeah, I suppose if you've never seen one before, it's probably quite an odd looking animal.
Yeah, I was caught off guard by how small it was, but I mean, it's almost like all the animals back home are on steroids. Like even the coyotes here look like babies compared to the ones back home. But yeah, where I live, it's pretty amplified in the wildlife category.
We may have touched on this earlier with a question, but Owen White would like to know how you're finding life in Chelmsford and what the main differences are between playing sort of American college hockey and playing over here.
I've enjoyed Chelmsford. I mean, the people have been incredible to me so far. I've got no bad things to say about it here. It's obviously tough being away from family. That's really the only thing, but that's kind of what you get when you move away to play hockey. But I'd say the biggest playing difference really is I find like back home it's a lot more, I guess you could say, like structured play. Like there's a lot of it's a lot more gritty. Like the goals you get are kind of just banging away at rebounds and stuff. There's not a lot of pretty goals, whereas here I find it's like almost comparable to football. Like when I watch a football match, how it's more like technical and guys are looking to make plays, which I've enjoyed a lot here. Like even playing with my line mates, like I find we have a lot of nice passing plays, stuff like that. It's just like there's a lot less time, I guess, back home with the puck, I find. And guys are always trying to hit you, fight you and stuff like that. I mean, it's not very different here, obviously, which I like, but it's a pretty comparable game style, I'd say, here to back home. Just obviously you get a few guys that are extremely good back home, which makes a huge difference. But yeah,
you did, as you say, like making the plays. You scored a lovely goal over at Milton Keynes a couple of weeks ago, which I'll put on the screen now for everyone that's watching. And that's probably our biggest and best arena at our level that you'll play in.
Yeah.
When we played away down at Solent, I was talking to some of the fans and we all said we would love to have seen your face when you walked in there.
Oh yeah, the boys, they were lined up waiting for me. It was funny. I was like getting an earful from a bunch of guys on the way down there and weeks prior. But in all honesty, when I walked in, I was pretty blown away by how small it was. It didn't seem as small as everyone described it until I got on the ice. Like for warmups, I remember getting on and I took like two strides and looked up and I was already at the goal line. I almost skated like directly into the board. So I think like when you're on the ice, you're kind of like, holy cow, it caught me off guard. But
you scored a hat trick in that game there, didn't you?
Yeah, I kind of liked it in all honesty. I had a good game there, but it's definitely the smallest rink I've ever played on in a game.
Yeah, I know a lot of players that have said about playing there, they've kind of said it's perfect because you don't have to skate too far to get anywhere. And then obviously Milton Keynes is the exact opposite. Biggest pad in the league. Mm-hmm. And it could be quite difficult, I suppose, which is something, because the Chieftains rink is kind of an average size, I suppose, actually in the league, the pad itself, that you're having to adapt the game style every single game.
Yeah, it's definitely a more, you got to be kind of more adjustable every week, I guess, with how things go in game style. Like I know you go from playing in Solent, that was a game I've never really experienced before. I mean, I remember I took like four strides and I was already, I think I scored the one goal I scored. I took like five strides from our own zone and just shot it and it went in. So that was, I've never done that before. And then you go to a place like Milton Keynes, and that's kind of more what I'm used to, I guess, back home, is like a bigger ice surface. I mean, we don't have much Olympic ice, but everything's at least, I guess, NHL standard. But yeah, I actually really enjoy Riverside as well. It's a good rink. I've enjoyed it. We have a good atmosphere in there every weekend. It seems like a lot of fans. I mean, it's really all you can ask for when you play.
Yeah, I was just going to ask about the atmosphere, actually, because it's something that even a lot of players in the other teams in the league always say they love playing at the Riverside because the atmosphere is electric. And the fans have really taken to you really quickly. You have become quite a fan favorite.
No, I mean, I love it. I enjoy playing at home, and you feed off the crowd and the energy in the arena. It only makes you skate a little harder, do things a little faster. And it's always in Arizona, we had some nights where if the football team was playing, or football is basically American football is the US's sport. So whenever we'd have like a rival game or something, you get a lot of fans. But then there's some nights where you could hear a pin drop in the crowd. So it's been nice to have a full rank every Sunday. That's really all you can ask for as a player. And I've enjoyed the fans and the support. I definitely feel the love. So it's been awesome so far.
Yeah. There's a Saturday home game this week as well that we don't normally get too many of them. So they're normally a really special atmosphere.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to that. I know the boys are as well. We're excited. We're angry, obviously, losing to Stratton this past weekend. So we're going to come out hard and try and put on a show for all the fans who show up to that.
Yeah. You said then about American football, but you've had a soccer experience since you've been here. You did some of the boys take you up to West Ham?
Yeah, the boys, they took me over to West Ham. I mean, it's funny, being back in North America, I've always been a big fan of the Premier League. Like, I've always watched it. It's not very popular back home. I've gotten a lot of my American and Canadian teammates to kind of follow along with it as well, just because I always had it on. But to go to a game was unbelievable. The first game I went to was with Ollie. We went to the Chelsea Arsenal derby match, which that was pretty cool. And then seeing like the London Stadium with West Ham, that was just incredible as well. Like, I couldn't believe how many people were in that stadium, and the chants are like, that's just like unbelievable to me. We don't get that back home with anything. So that was pretty cool. Yeah, I've enjoyed it. It's a fun sport to watch live as well. I couldn't believe how much faster it is in person. So that was an experience I'll never forget.
Yeah. No. Have you adopted a British team?
I have. I'm trying to. It's why all the boys are trying to make me pick a team. I'm kind of just a fan of the sport at the moment. But if I had to pick two, I guess it would be Chelsea and West Ham. Just the two teams I've watched. So the boys. Some of the boys might not like that answer, but
no, they'll definitely tell you can't support two London teams. You can probably support two teams, but not two London teams.
Yeah,
but. Something that when we've been speaking, we said we'd touch on this. Obviously, the incident of the weekend where you took the stick to the face, there was no call. Is the officiating something that's frustrated you? Because it has frustrated a lot of players so far this year. There's been some long bans handed out for fairly minuscule things. There's been things that haven't even been looked at and no bans given. How have you found that?
I think if I had to critique one thing, I think with this league, it would be the officiating. And it's, I get it. They're doing their job and they're doing the best they can at times. It just feels like there's some like game killing calls, like even the 5 minute against Stratton in the third. It's tough because, a play like that shouldn't happen, but the suspensions, especially like the import on Oxford, the 10 gamer, I saw the video of that and I was pretty blown away that that's a 10 game suspension, but it's out of our hands, those decisions. But even a high stick to the face like this right in front, and the ref was 5 feet away and he's telling me that I fell on the stick and busted my face open. It just, you kind of shake your head. It's just the one frustrating part of the game really over here. I think it's just the officiating. It almost seems like sometimes it's the ref show, but that's really the only thing I would have to say. It's annoying me, but we have to accept it and there's nothing we can do about it. And there's some games where it feels like they're definitely against us and we're getting a lot of calls. But I think in the last few weeks, we've really been working on just the team discipline and in general, and trying to not make that a factor of the games. But yeah, there's, I mean, even Kieran Rayner's suspension, like it just feels like if you do anything bad, it's 6 games minimum, which I mean, back home, you, if you see a 6-game suspension, someone would have had to have done something like seriously wrong to even get 5 or 6. So it's those lengthy ones that I've never seen before in my career. And I've been playing for quite a while, but yeah, it's frustrating, but there's not much we can do about it. I just hope, you know, it's a more fairly called game in some situations. Like you see Barnes get sticked in the private area in the third period and there's no call. And then the player's kind of like, he knows he can get away with it for the rest of the game. I'm getting slashed, getting sticked in places you shouldn't be getting sticks in and there's no call. So, you know, like you want to feel like the refs are keeping you safe out there. That's kind of their job, is to control the game. And there's some games where definitely players feel like if something happens to them, there's going to be nothing justified. And that's why you have guys like Alan Lack, I guess, to go in and set guys straight. Like he's been kind of the dad of the team for sure. He's awesome. He's a great guy. But
yeah, I think when he was announced, because he was the first player to be announced for this year's roster.
Yeah.
And then on the first game, when everyone noticed the C on his jersey, everyone was like, yeah, that's 100% the right call.
Yep. No, I couldn't have named a better captain on our team. He's an exceptional leader and an even better person. I mean, he's texting me all the time, making sure I'm good. And he has a family of his own. And yeah, no, it's really, it's, they go above and beyond to make sure I'm taken care of, even though they got so much on their plates. But a guy like Locke is just the heart and soul of any team he's on. And you can't really ask for a better teammate than a guy like him. He's really like your ideal leader and person off on and off the ice. So he does his job exceptionally well.
Yeah. Your number 67, I noticed you've worn a couple of different numbers, just looking at your sort of your previous pictures of your teams. Is there anything to that number for you?
Honestly, every year, so we always play inline hockey in the summers and roller hockey. And I used to be number 88. I've always liked number 8. I'm not going to take it from the Bartletts, obviously, but 67 is always the number I seem to always fall on. It's nothing too special, really. I've just always really taken interest in that number. So when I found out I was able to get a hold of it again over here, I jumped on it. But yeah, there's not really like a story or anything behind it. I think I've just always really enjoyed that number. And so, yeah, that's really
it. I've got a question from Sophia, who is known around the rink as the sign girl. You may have seen in the at the balcony end in the corner, a cardboard sign up in the corner. Sophia does her own signs, normally different every week, and that she puts a great deal of effort into it. She's fantastic. And she's asked, if you could be in any film or television franchise for a day, what would it be?
It's a good question. That is a really good question. I don't know. It's put me on the spot with that.
She does that to everybody.
I would say, I've always liked like sport documentaries. Obviously, you got to be a pro athlete to be in any of those. But
well, you say that there's the social media at the moment, especially around the Britain division, there's an awful lot of behind the scenes stuff going on. I think the Slough Jets have got their own social media page for behind the scenes. The Invicta Dynamos put some great videos out. Is that something that you guys would enjoy? Do you think?
I think we would enjoy something like that. I'd probably need to get someone in there to be filming us all the time, probably get some pretty good comments and jokes out of the boys if we had a camera crew following us around. But yeah, I think shows like that are personally my favorite. So to be in something like that, I think it brings out everyone's personality a bit more. And so yeah, I guess I'd have to be like a behind the scenes kind of show within sports or something like that. That would be fun if we had something like that to take part in.
Yeah, obviously it would have probably been sacrilege for you to watch it, but did you watch the All or Nothing Maple Leafs on Amazon?
I haven't watched that one yet. I know I've been getting the gears from some of the boys, but we have there's a show like that for the Oilers that I always watch. My parents, they grew up in Edmonton, so they're diehard Oiler fans. So we have some interesting Battle of Alberta nights. I got to sit in a different room than them watch those games. But I grew up watching the Oilers All or Nothing kind of show. So yeah, that was a good one.
Yeah, the really interesting thing with the Toronto one is that it took place during COVID, and it was amazing to see just how quickly the NHL reacted and just said, right, well, Canadian teams play Canadian teams, American teams play American teams, and then no one's breaking any rules. Whereas over here, it took them so long to get the sport going again. All sport, be it football, rugby, or you know anything that was going on. And that was, yeah, how quick they were was brilliant.
Yeah, I was impressed by that. I mean, it was nice to be sitting at home in the middle of June or July and you're watching, you know, the Canadian teams go at it or some really good American rivalries as well. It was nice to see that. It was obviously such a weird time, I think, for everyone in the world having to deal with COVID and no fans in the arenas and stuff like that. Even I have a few buddies who play in the National Hockey League and just talking to them, like it was just such a different atmosphere. And being in the bubble was, I think, a lot more strenuous than people might realize, having to live in a hotel for 2 months when your family's on the other side of the country or something like that. But yeah, it's they definitely didn't skip a beat with getting sports back on TV, which definitely helped kill some nights and entertain a lot of people. So it was nice to see. But yeah, it's such a weird time to think back on, honestly, now.
Yeah. And you would know more than most about having your family on the other side of the world when you're over here playing. Obviously, we've been speaking since you've sort of come over, but they were able to watch the Milton Keynes game, weren't they, on live stream?
Yeah, it's the only game they've been able to watch so far. I mean, it's tough. My mom and dad, they're huge fans of watching me play, and so it'd be nice if we were able to stream home games somehow, just so they were able to watch. But
yeah, I think it's something that they all need to do now. It's,
yeah.
I mean, as much as I mean, obviously, I'm doing this. I've got, you know, a little bit of technology going on, but I don't really know what it takes. I don't know what sort of camera they need. Do they need a commentator? How do they stream it onto YouTube or onto the Ticket Co platform where it can be charged for? Mm-hmm. It's not going to stop people coming to the games. It's for your away fans or for your imports families. That's what it's for.
Definitely, yeah. I think there needs to be some kind of platform for that. I think it grows the league as well, having video footage. Like, I mean, most people who I know back home, they when they're talking to teams in like Europe, for example, like they're immediately going to YouTube or finding footage or videos as much as they can on the teams to study up. And it's tough to like explain the league back home to people just because there's no video really or anything. And
yeah, well, I think
it'd do the league more good than bad streaming the games.
Absolutely. I know Oxford do occasionally stream their home games, so I'll see what I can find out and I'll let you know, because this Sunday's game away at Oxford might well be live streamed. So if it is, I'll let you know.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
But Damon, thank you so much for joining me. It's been a real pleasure to talk to you. It's a pleasure to have you playing in Chelmsford. You're a pleasure to watch every week, and I really hope you're enjoying it.
Thank you. Yep. No, thank you for having me. I've enjoyed it.
Have you got an ambition for this season? Something that you sort of pointed out and said, yeah, we want to achieve this.
I mean, obviously the team goal is we want to win the league. We want to take down Stratton. So yeah, I'd say that's my goal, is find a way to get in there and take over the crown. That's definitely the goal.
And then get ourselves to that showpiece in Milton Keynes.
Exactly. Yep. That's the goal for me.
Good man. Damon Porter, thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Thanks for having me.